knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Continuing with our introduction to Panarthropoda, Phylum Onychophora is the only entirely terrestrial animal phylum. That is, every single described member of this phylum lives only in the terrestrial environment. There is not a single aquatic species. They are commonly called velvet worms due to their physical appearance. Their texture gives them a velvet appearance, and they superficially resemble worms, or perhaps elongated caterpillars. The phylum name Onychophora comes from the ancient Greek onychase for claws and pherein for to carry. They are often small, though they can range from 0.5 to 15 centimeters in length, and are often found in rainforests and other similar habitats with heavy vegetation and consistent rainfall. They are the smallest phylum of Panarthropoda in terms of biodiversity, and include about 180 described species in 10 genera, though there may be many more species that are currently undescribed. They are comprised of just two families that are found mainly in Central and South America, Oceania, and South Asia. All velvet worms are active predators that prey upon invertebrates, usually insects, that they capture by ejecting an adhesive slime and consume using toothlet-covered mandibles. In order to more fully explain the velvet worms, we will discuss their external anatomy, internal anatomy, behavior, habitat and distribution, and finally, conservation. In terms of external anatomy, though the onychophorans look quite a bit like walking worms or caterpillars, they do not show external segmentation except for their paired appendages. They are soft-bodied and covered in a thin, flexible cuticle that very much resembles an arthropod cuticle, except that it never fully hardens, and it is shed in patches instead of all at once. Their entire body, including their stub feet, is covered by sensory papillae, which carry a mechanoreceptive bristle at the tip and connect to sensory nerves to provide a sense of touch. On their head, they bear a pair of large antennae, which also function in sensory perception. At the base of each antenna, they have a simple eye, complete with ball lens, cornea, and retina that are homologous to the arthropod ocelli. Ventrally, from the antennae and eyes, they have oral papillae, which house their slime glands and oral lobes that surround the mouth, which bears their claw-like mandibles. Continuing ventrally, velvet worms have 14 to 43 pairs of unjointed legs that are short, stubby, and clawed. The total number of pairs differs by species and individual. Some species have a set number of legs, and others vary by sex or individual. Onychophoran internal anatomy includes the respiratory, digestive, circulatory, muscular, nervous, reproductive, and excretory systems, along with a hydrostatic skeleton. For respiration, velvet worms use a tracheal system that connects to all parts of the body and directly into individual cells for gas exchange. Oxygen is piped into cells, and carbon dioxide is released. These connect to the world outside of the body through numerous openings, or spiracles. Like all members of Panarthropoda, velvet worms breathe through their spiracles, not their mouths. Like the arthropods, velvet worms have a body cavity known as a pseudoscience, or hemocoel, which functions as a major part of the circulatory system, and their hydrostatic skeleton, which provides them with support through fluid pressure, since unlike the arthropods, velvet worms do not have a hardened exoskeleton. The hemocoel is a body cavity filled with a blood-like liquid called hemolymph, in which all the organs are embedded. It is pigmentless and does not carry oxygen, since the tracheal system already does that. It contains amebocytes that protect from infection and play a role in reproduction, and nephrocytes, which absorb toxins and transport them to the excretory system, which empties from a pair of nephridia that is found on each leg-bearing body segment. Their digestive system is complete and begins with the physical dismembering of the prey using mandibles and external digestion by injected saliva. Liquefied food is sucked up through the pharynx and pumped into the esophagus into the gut, where it is further broken down by enzymes and digested. Undigested food passes to the rectum and out the anus. The velvet worm muscular system is comprised of smooth muscular tissue within their connective tissue and of a voluminous layer of inner longitudinal muscles lined by diagonal muscles that wind backwards along the body axis and are fed by thin blood vessels. Their nervous system is organized like a ladder with paired ventral nerve cords that run the length of the body. Nerves connect from the brain to the antennae, or tentacles, and connect sensory organs, including their simple eyes, taste organs around the mouth, and touch organs around the body. Their reproductive system consists of a large pair of gonads that open into a common genital opening known as the gonopore. Nearly all species are dioecious, meaning individuals are either male or female, except for a single species, Epiperipatus imthurni, in which no males have ever been observed, and reproduces by parthenogenesis. One last part of their anatomy that is entirely unique to velvet worms are their slime glands. Velvet worms can forcefully squirt glue-like slime from the oral papillae either in defense against predators or to capture prey. The slime itself is produced deep within their slime glands and can be expelled at a speed of 3 to 5 meters per second, at a distance of about 10 to 30 centimeters or more. The adhesive hardens when outside of the body, trapping prey and confusing predators. Velvet worm behavior involves feeding, locomotion, sociality, and reproduction. In terms of feeding, velvet worms are ambush predators that hunt at night, mostly searching for termites, cockroaches, crickets, and spiders. When a velvet worm has found prey and trapped it in its fast-drying adhesive, they creep up on it and search for soft openings in its body using their antennae, puncture the prey with their sharp mandibles, and inject it with saliva that kills it quickly. The onychophorin then allows the prey to be digested as it re-ingests its own slime, sucking up the liquefied invertebrate with its pharynx. Their movements are always slow and gradual, and they often seem to lumber. They move both legs of a pair in unison, and their claws are only used on rough terrain, otherwise they step on the foot cushions on the base of the claws. Velvet worms appear to be somewhat social animals, and some species have been found to live in social groups made of up to 15 individuals. These groups live and move and even hunt together, and they can be aggressive and territorial towards other groups. They also appear to have a form of social hierarchy that is maintained through chasing and biting. Their communal sociality is still being studied. Velvet worm mating behaviors are still considered to be cryptic and rarely observed. Females are often larger than males and may have more legs. In many species, females are only fertilized once in their entire lives, and they store sperm within a special reservoir where it can remain viable for longer periods. Mating is always internal and may involve a true penis or the use of amebocytes, which are transferred from the female's blood and cause the release of sperm cells, which move freely within the female hemocoel before penetrating the wall of the ovaries. Some species lay eggs, while others hold eggs within their bodies and give birth to live young, and still others simply bear live young. Females have been found to give birth to 1 to 23 offspring per year, and the development from fertilized ovum to adult takes between 6 and 17 months. The offspring directly develop into miniature forms of their parents and lack a larval stage. Though we've mentioned velvet worm habitat and distribution before, it deserves a second glance. Wherever velvet worms are found, they are always sparsely distributed and often quite rare. They are found only in tropical habitats and in the temperate zone of the southern hemisphere, where they demonstrate a circumtropical distribution. Very few species show any overlap with human-modified land uses, and often require fairly pristine rainforests to survive. So due to this habitat necessity and restriction, velvet worms are often studied in terms of ecological conservation. The conservation status of individual species is difficult to gauge because of a lack of reliable data, their nocturnal behavior, low densities, and relative fragility. As of 2023, out of the only 11 species of velvet worms evaluated by the IUCN, 3 were critically endangered, 2 were endangered, 4 were vulnerable, 1 was near threatened, and 1 lacked sufficient data. It is likely that the vast majority, or perhaps even all species of velvet worms, are in decline around the world as their pristine habitats are further reduced. Hopefully this does not spell their extinction. And on that unfortunate note, we've summarized the velvet worms. Let's move forward and explore the largest and most diverse animal phylum of all, Arthropoda.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.